I'm the convener of the ANU Gender Institute, and I'm really delighted to welcome you here to this conversation today. And I'll be introducing our guests, who you no doubt have read about on the website flyer. But I thought it would be nice, given the Gender Institute is a cross-campus institute, to just let Jenny and Joan know in the room the breadth of your interests today, and also to help me in our in the questioning framework. So could we just go around and introduce ourselves to everybody? And okay,
maybe let's see if you can start. Hi, my name is Okay Wang. I'm from the Migrational Program.
I'm Janet Hadley-Williams, and I'm from English College of Arts and Social Sciences.
I'm Alison Ballard from University of Canberra.
Great, welcome.
Joan Vetras from the School of History.
Lars Moen, PhD student at politics.
I'm Desmond, and I'm based here, but also appointed in the Humanities and Social Sciences.
I'm Margie Rowe from the ANU College of Law.
And Dorota, do you want to introduce yourself?
Oh, it's Dorota from ANU College of Law.
I'm Vivian Holmes, I'm also from the College of Law.
Ali Gordon from the Department of IR in College of Asia Pacific.
I'm Mary Atkins, I'm also from
I'm Rachel Ball, I'm from the National Tertiary Education Union.
I'm Peter Ballant from UNSW in Canberra.
And from the support in the All right, well, I'm sure there'll be some others who trickle in, but we won't do a Diamanda average and get them to introduce themselves on late arrival. But I'm really delighted to be welcoming Professor Jenny Nedelsky and Professor Joe Carens here today. I want to first acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we're meeting and pay our respects to elders past and present. I'd also like to thank the Australian Catholic University for essentially enabling us to bring Joe and Jenny across, because at this stage we wouldn't have been able to fund you all the way from Toronto. But thankfully they are having a stint at ACU this year, and it's not the first visit. They are now professorial fellows in the Institute for Social Justice at ACU. And that means that they're in Australia for a period of time, which enabled us to cover their costs to come and spend some time here in Canberra. And I hope that this will be the first of an ongoing relationship in the sustaining of this particular framework. And we decided to do this in the context of the ANU Gender Institute, both because of Jenny's work, which we'll be concentrating on, but also both because the fact that Joe and Jenny are married and have navigated some of the issues that are relevant to Jenny's work and relevant to all of us as human beings in terms of the work-life balance, that I thought that we could gather some insights. And I think that Joe's research work in terms of social justice has overlay, of course, in terms of our thinking about some of these normative issues. So I want to also say that Edward's noise is not going to be too distracting these, so don't worry too much. In incorporating these principles, it is part of actually accepting that this is also a norm of our life that we want to embrace. So, speaking about norms, I thought I would begin the conversation. The way I'm thinking of structuring it is really starting to speak with Jenny first in relation to her work and the projects, then moving to Joe. I feel a bit like Michael Parkinson, for those of you who have watched some of his interviews, and then to come back to both of them in the third part of the conversation about that latter aspect, and then give time for questions as well. So we're taking this because there are a lot of people who, through work-life balance, are not able to be here at this moment, and hopefully they will enjoy this as a recording afterwards and be able to contact you independently by virtue of the wonderful internet system to be able to continue a conversation. But Jenny, talking about norms is really essential to your project, so I wonder if you could tell us how that is relevant to what you're working on.
Okay, so my project is driven now by a sense that our current norms about work and care are tremendously destructive They create problems of what passes for the language of work-family balance, failed balance. They also generate consistent and persistent inequality for everyone who does care. Women are most obvious, but they're not the only categories of people who are disadvantaged. Our whole structure of care is organized around hierarchies of disadvantage. And last, our norms of work and care mean that our policymakers, generally, high-level policymakers, generally have no firsthand, or very little firsthand experience of care. And I want to say that that makes them ignorant of a core dimension of human life and therefore unfit for their jobs. So I have a solution to this problem, which is not, in the first instance, a legal solution, but a change of norms. And so the expectation would be that, as some of you heard me say before, nobody does paid work more than 30 hours a week. Everybody does some paid work, minimum of 12. And everybody, no exceptions, does unpaid care work, also between 12 and 30 hours a week. So that's the basic frame of the project.
The resonating of the lack of knowledge by virtue of not having done care work actually resonates with a discussion that I just heard on the radio the other day in terms of the changes in board memberships. There's a lot of attention on in the public sphere about the gender balance on boards. And there was a discussion that Woolworths, which is a large supermarket chain, I don't know if it's the same in Canada, but a retail food produce board is the first board to have more women than men on their board. And the recognition that earlier boards of Woolworths had men who had never gone into a supermarket and had never had to push a trolley around the supermarket. And it resonates, I guess, with the notion of life experience being so fundamental to the ways in which we see power being played out in society.
Yes, and I think it's, I have kind of two claims that are part of this. The first is, I think, your point hits both of them. One is that there are many, many policy areas where one needs to have some sense of the centrality of care work to human thriving. So that's the first part. But the second part is that the only way to get the kind of knowledge you need is through experience. It's not going to be enough to get somebody to write you a policy memo or talk to your mother or talk to your sister. You actually have to do it. So it's a combination of a claim about experiential knowledge, which at least in North America is a big buzzword for professional education, legal education, but not necessarily with the full depth that I have in mind. So it's both that you need to know about care, you need to know why it matters, not just why it's economically important. So feminist economists have done a tremendous job of showing us that, you know, we couldn't survive, we couldn't function as a society without the unpaid care labor. But the problem with that side of it is that it casts care as a burden, mostly. And I want to insist, of course it is a burden under our current arrangements, but it's also a tremendous benefit. And so part of what I'm trying to do is to bring both of those things into focus.
Can you, I've got the benefit of some of the draft of this work, and early on you say that the project is building on the work of Nancy Fraser. I'm wondering if you could share with people how that is the case.
So some of you will know Nancy Fraser's wonderful piece After the Family Wage, where she lays out kind of different models. She thinks of the North American model as basically the universal breadwinner. So women should become like men, basically. And in some ways I was inspired to really go forward with this project when I was at a panel at the American Political Science Meetings on care in Asia and Latin America. And I was really shocked to find out how much this model, that the path to gender equality is full-time employment for women, is spreading across the world. And how is that going to work? It's by hiring poorer women from somewhere else to come in and do the care work. And this, you know, the expansion of what seems to me such a dramatically failed model, I found really disturbing, and I thought it was very important to offer an alternative. But so that's the universal breadwinner model, and she posits an alternative, which is you try to make sure that those who do the care work are not disadvantaged. So you have a division, still often a gendered division, but you try to respond to the disadvantages so that you protect the caregivers. And she has criteria of equality, basically equality and democracy, and she says neither model can meet them. And we need instead a universal caregiver. Everybody becomes a caregiver. So that was a kind of early intellectual inspiration, but I think in some ways the more powerful inspiration was thinking from the time I first had my own kids about how unsustainable the current arrangements are. And you know, my kids are now 26 and 29, and I look at my young colleagues, my young women colleagues at my faculty of law, and I don't think life is any better for them 30 years later, and that's an incredibly depressing state of affairs.
Mm-hmm. How does it link in, and I haven't asked you this in advance, mm-hmm. with Anne-Marie Slaughter's interventions?
So, I think, so I have a positive and a negative thing to say. On the one hand, I think they're very important because they bring a lot of attention, and also the lean in, that's a big, I don't know, so that's a big thing here too. So,
we should probably say Anne-Marie Slaughter was working in the White House. And,
right,
and
she worked for Secretary Clinton when she was Secretary of State, and while she was had children of her own who were living in Princeton, New Jersey, and she was commuting to Washington to do this, and so the positive side is, you know, the title, sort of positive side, the title of the big article in The Atlantic was Women Still Can't Have It All. But it's a mistake to think that even with a sympathetic employer, as she depicts Secretary Clinton, it's really not possible to function at that very high level and sustain a family if there are high demands in the family. And so I think she is recommending that we transform work to be more flexible around the demands of family. But I think it doesn't go far enough. It's more about how to recognize different life stages and life cycle. I think my project calls for a much more fundamental transformation. And I think part of the problem, so you can't say that the reason we need my project is because nobody recognizes there's a work-family balance problem. Everybody recognizes this. There's a whole management literature on this, which is sort of how to make your employees less miserable without really changing anything. And you know, at least in the US, the New York Times has something. Kind friends and acquaintances, family members send me things from the New York Times. You know, you get two or three a week that are on work-family balance, but it's all, in my opinion, kind of tinkering at the edges. It's not talking about fundamental transformation. And so I think even Anne-Marie Slaughter and the lean-in message they're not getting at the fundamental transformation we need.
And you write about that fundamental transformation involving, you know, fundamental norm change.
Yes.
Could you talk a little bit more about how this fits with democratic deliberation?
Yes. So let me just say I won't tell the whole story, but one phrase about norm change. So what I have in mind is that today, if an adult man is at a cocktail party and he says, oh, you know, I've never held a job, I'm not really interested in that kind of thing, that would be embarrassing. People would respond with pity or concern or disapproval, something. So I want that kind of affective, normative response to be what happens if that same man says, oh, I don't do care work, you know, I'm a really talented, highly trained, specialized person, and I don't waste my time on care. And I do work 70 hours a week, I really contribute a lot to society. That person should be met with, oh, you know, I know a counselor you could see. So it could be sympathetic, but it would be a clear sense that this was a transgression. This person was not living up to our collective norms of what we expect from responsible, competent adults. So that's what I mean by norm change. I should just say, you know, in the background on the work side, there will be a set of legal facilitations that are necessary to protect good part-time work, to encourage businesses to be creative about generating different kinds of work structures. But my primary interest is in these
norms.
Democratic deliberation.
Yes. So I think, you know, there's a huge literature on democratic deliberation, but mostly it's aimed at policy that is going to take the form of legislation or administration, some kind of legal structure. And so, except for the IR people who do some work on, you know, international norm transfer, which is often, you know, how you can get the bad cultures to be like the good cultures. But at least it's an inquiry into norm change. But the democratic deliberation people don't tend to focus on norms. And so what I want to do, really the purpose of this, I hope, short and accessible book, is to shift this the form of the work-family balance conversation onto the more fundamental, so that there's democratic deliberation in the sense that there was, you know, at the rise of the second wave of feminism. It's happening everywhere. Everywhere you go, playgrounds, coffee shops, classrooms, everybody is talking about, well, how do we really like to organize our lives of work and care? And how might we do this, that it becomes, you know, a kind of incredibly ubiquitous subject of conversation.
Okay, so I might hold that there so that we can move on to, in my thinking, shift but stay consistent in terms of thinking about the way we value human beings mm-hmm. in our world into a more state-oriented sense, so from the sort of domestic, maybe private realm, although the private is another aspect mm-hmm. of a discussion that would flow from this discussion, into the foreign policy, international approach to the way we treat fellow human beings when they're not our own citizens and when they're seeking to move from one nation state to another. So interestingly, there's an annual lecture here, Joe, called the Alan Martin Lecture in the History School. He was an historian here at ANU, and last week's lecture was presented by Joy DeMuzzi, who is a historian at Melbourne University, not the law school, who talked about the changes in the way the depiction of the child migrant had evolved historically. She's doing historical work. And what was really striking was the move from sympathy to lack of sympathy, both in terms, well, mainly in a governmental sense. I think part of her research is showing that there's still so much public sympathy and desire, but that the formal discourse has changed significantly. And I was wondering if you could reflect about that to the extent that you've looked at these things historically and the way your work on the values of the nation state in terms of accepting non-citizens and immigrants plays into that perhaps.
So that's really interesting talking about. It's not something I felt. So what Kim is referring to is I've written a book recently about the ethics of immigration, which is attempting to ask what are the normative issues that emerge with respect to immigration. And I try to do this at two levels, but not historically. So there's an interesting set of questions about how things change over time, but mine is more analytic. And I'm trying to say, in the first instance, so I'm trying both to think about what's possible in the here and now, and the degree to which we have norms and principles that should guide our public policies, and also about also to stand back and criticize those norms and principles and to think about what's right at the ideal and how do you sustain both forms of reflection without having one undercut the other. So
maybe take us through those principles and we can think maybe in relation to
that. Okay, for me, in the book anyway, the simple way to do that was to start with questions about access to citizenship, because this is something that at least states in Australia and North America, they do a pretty good job. So I have a discussion of birthright citizenship, and I say that's the reasonable thing to do, and it should extend to the children of immigrants. So part of the argument there against certain kind of European patterns is to say, if you look at the reasons why we make children citizens at birth, children who are the children of citizens, Why do you make somebody a citizen? And if you unpack those reasons, you find out the same reasons will apply to the children of immigrants who have settled there. And so, therefore, the idea that Children who are born in a society and expect to grow up there should get citizenship at birth applies both to the children of citizens and the children of immigrants. And that's not so far from existing policy. That's just a way of unpacking what is the underlying rationale for an existing practice that actually makes sense. And similarly with what rights should people have who are permanent residents. So for the most part, with some qualifications, states in Europe and North America do a pretty good job of that, which is to say they give them all the same rights as citizens, except for the right to participate in politics. And so that's interesting too, because it kind of unsettles a conventional idea. Citizenship is the right to have rights, right? A lot of you probably heard that phrase, Hannah Arendt. But actually, citizenship isn't the right to have rights. Lots of people have rights without being citizens. Very secure, firm rights, as secure almost as the... Right? So that's another way to kind of disrupt the kind of conventional, but to see our practices have a normative logic that makes sense. Then as you start to move to other areas, so then I talk about the rights of temporary workers. I'm going to skip that. That's more mixed. Then when you get to people who have arrived without the state's permission, so irregular migrants, I call them undocumented, but those that don't like them call them illegal, so people who have arrived without the state's permission. So I make an argument about why they ought to have certain sets of rights as well, so now I'm moving a little further away from practice, though not completely away from what might is feasible in some contexts. Then I try to switch the frame. So that whole first part of the book is about, not about who should get in, but about people who have gotten in, one way or another, and how they should be treated. And the second half of the book is about who should get in, and again, here I do a kind of layered thing. I say, well, let's assume states get to control. Still, they don't have absolute power, so what about, what are the constraints? And everybody recognizes, for example, you can't any longer discriminate on the basis of race, religion. That isn't safe. So that discrimination goes on. We know that in various subtle forms, but nobody announces it. Well done. So now you always have to qualify these things. You know, you used to be able to say, well, nobody thinks, but it turns out, but almost nobody actually thinks that you can announce we can exclude X or Y. Said that's no longer thought to be acceptable in most.
Except Donald Trump.
Donald Trump, exactly. That's the you know, used to be able to say nobody, and now we have Donald Trump who contradicts everything that you thought you couldn't say. And family reunification is another constraint. Most states recognize some sort of claim about people to you don't treat people with close family ties in quite the same way that you treat people who, so they're astute, but that having a close family tie to somebody who's already present as a citizen or a resident gives you a claim to entry that is much stronger than the normal. Most states recognize that to some degree, so again, I try to articulate that. Then I turn to the question of refugees. And again, there, I'm working within the framework. So the background framework in this whole discussion is states have the right to decide who gets in. And the discussion of refugees, I think, is usefully taken within that same framework because, what I call the conventional view, because refugees are seen as an exception to that norm. The norm is states get to decide who gets in, but refugees are an exception because we recognize that they've got a special kind of claim to entry, and that's the Geneva Convention, and so on recognizes that, even though it's in a background context of states get to control entry. But here you agree that if somebody shows up on your door and says that I'm a refugee, you have to give them a hearing, and if they qualify, you can't kick them out. Of course, now we found all these. So what that chapter is about is about how we found ways to subvert that principle, right? So we have that nice sounding, it's got the constraint, of course, that you have to show up, but now we've introduced all these mechanisms to prevent people from showing up, which I don't have to say in Australia, right? And the whole goal is to prevent them from having, we say, we're going to give you this entitlement, and the whole goal is to prevent you from getting access to that entitlement of me arriving on the territory and claiming that. And that's a subversion of the... And the other thing that I try to show lies behind what's problematic with the existing refugee regime is kind of... So on the one hand, people recognize refugees have special claims, and what are those special claims? Well, in the first instance, it's a claim to a safe place to live, but that's okay for 6 months or a year, but it's not okay in the long run. So if people can't go back home, they should find a new home. Well, who should provide that? Well, nobody wants to talk about that. And that's what's so striking in Europe today and so on. You know, they stop, keep them in Turkey. Well, is Turkey supposed to supply these people with these 4 million Syrian refugees with a new home? And why is that Turkey's responsibility? Lebanon, a quarter of its population. Jordan, millions of... So there's no, that's just not on the table. When they say, well, there are threats, we've got to keep them out, there's just too many, we can't have this burden. it seems implausible to me that you can say Lebanon can take in a quarter of its population, but we can't take in a tenth of 1%. You know, there just isn't a story that people can tell about why that's okay. And so nobody talks about it. So I try to bring that into visibility. But here, one of the difficulties with the refugees, we start to move into, you can see about what's right and what's wrong with the existing arrangements, but politically, the chances of doing anything about it are small. So before, kind of the reforms, you could kind of see maybe it's contestable in here. So that's just, and that's accepting the background framework that states are entitled to control. So the final part of the book is about why actually that framework, this assumption that we all have, that you're entitled to control who gets in, is itself problematic. And the short version here is this is kind of like feudalism in the Middle Ages. Some people are born into the nobility, some into the peasantry, right? Most people into the peasantry. And so being born into a rich state, Australia, Canada, the United States, European states, it's like being born into the nobility, if you're a lesser nobility. And being born into the vast majority of places in the world is like being born into the peasantry. So a few peasants get to become nobles and so on, but there's this radical division of life chances based on the circumstances of birth. And then controls on mobility, which was also true in feudalism, prevent you from changing those circumstances. So nobody today defends feudalism. Nobody says, oh, that was a good system, let's go back to that. They all think of that, oh, that was unjust, how could they put up with it? So you think about the way we've organized the world. The world is not naturally organized this way, we've organized it. So what justifies it? And so I say, nothing, but we have to change it. So that again is a kind of ideal theory. It's not a political program, it's not something the Minister for Immigration or Justice is about to adopt, I know that. But still, you have to be able to kind of stand back and recognize the possibility of something radically wrong with the way we've organized our worlds, and then to try to think about ways of moving in a different direction. So that's good.
So both of you have very small projects at hand here. But I just, you know, for the context in Australia and your discussion, it is really interesting if you reflect back, as you know, the links between citizenship and migration. Because, of course, in Australia, we have seen that shift away from those fundamental notions like birth in country leading to citizenship. That was changed in the 1980s purely because of the fear that it would give immigration advantage to individuals. So that all of the questions about citizenship have been framed through immigration policy perspectives rather than from broader normative notions of membership and connection to territory that individuals may have, regardless of the flow-on. And then the other aspect, before we move on to the third part, is the links with citizenship and the changes in discourse in terms of the protections that citizenship provide. And both in Australia and in Canada, we've seen these very, in my view, regressive changes to legislation which enable the state to strip dual citizens of their citizenship. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you can say a little bit about that in terms of how your work then plays in to that discussion and policy.
So there's a principled question, which is whether or not people should have dual citizenship, and I've got a little discussion in the book about why they should, that the kind of rationale. Mm-hmm. The short version is like this. We don't think it's a problem. The dual loyalty is the big challenge. Oh, how can you be loyal to two countries? And I say, well, it's not so hard to be loyal to two parents. You know, you often have the motherland, the fatherland. Which one do you want, your mother or your father? You have to choose, you know. And we don't think that's necessary. And so, and the legal technicalities, you know, there is now lots of experience with dual citizenship. So the legal problems, which are imagined to be so great, are not very great in practice. So I think at the principled level, there aren't many people. Some people want to insist you can only vote in one country or something like that, but the kinds of, which is okay, you can set those sorts of rules, But the kind of legal opposition to dual citizenship has largely dissipated, it seems to me, among scholars. Politically, it's clear this is just a symbolic exercise, right? This isn't going to do any good in terms of, say, challenge. It's all about terrorism, and it's not going to actually do anything to reduce terrorism. It's part of that symbolic politics of kind of defining a them who is not us. That's essentially, it seems to me, what that's about. Important to challenge it, but lots of things that, there are some philosophically interesting questions or morally interesting questions. This is not a hard one morally, it's just a hard one politically.
Yeah. Okay, so there are the sort of political worlds in which each of your projects, you know, to play out will involve lots of, you know, changes and aspects. But let's move to the personal worlds in the way that we integrate these sort of aspects into our lives. And I thought I'd start with you, Jenny, in terms of the fact that you've on a number of occasions, I guess, thought about these issues in relation to your own personal life, and you have an article about it. So perhaps you could tell everybody a little bit about that article, and then we'll merge into your life experiences.
Okay. So when my first child was born, we had just moved to Canada. We didn't have family there. We didn't have close friends because we'd only been there for a year. And he almost died at birth. And so it was all very challenging and demanding, and I didn't have tenure. Everybody had said I should finish my book, which was required for tenure before the baby was born, because otherwise I was doomed. But I didn't. And for me, Michael's arrival made me feel grounded in the world in a way that actually made me able to finally write that book that I'd been trying to write for many years. And so it had the reverse sort of effect on me. And I started making notes about this, and then I was asked by Sarah Ruddick, some of you may know her, a well-known feminist theorist in the US. She was putting together a book which ultimately was called Mother Troubles, about the tensions for feminists around motherhood. And so I got a chance to write up this article about my experience. And then it actually, that article ended with what I think of now as the first piece of the project I'm now doing, a reflection on the low status of care in our society, that both the care itself and the people who do it are denigrated, and that this is just a profoundly unhealthy relationship to care. So I did actually get to write that article, and I think the ideas for what I'm doing now are percolating along all the way.
So now I haven't canvassed with Joe and Jenny my exact question, so if you tell me this is, you don't want to discuss it, but to the extent that you made that choice to have kids, how much did you deliberate between you as to what the consequences would be for you in your relationship?
Well, you know, I don't think we did deliberate very much. We were both, it was a second marriage for both of us. Joe actually had a memorable conversation with Jerry Cohen, who asked Joe, well, so what about children? And Joe said, we're thinking about it. And he said, better think fast.
Because I was 40 and Jenny was 37. So.
Yeah, so that was true. 36. So then I was. Well, because we did think fast and we got going, and so I had my first child when I was 37, and the second one, so not quite 37, and the second one not quite 40. But anyway, it was more, well, we better do this. So I'm just gonna anticipate kind of the next part, and then Joe can. So, you know, there's a lot of depressing literature out there that the as they call them in North America, the millennial generation, actually, these young people think they're going to have egalitarian relationships, both the men and the women. And they get married with that expectation, and they're actually, if you look at the income curves, these young men and women are very close. And then they have a kid, and everything collapses. And they fall back into gendered roles that neither of them had ever anticipated. But I'll say that for us, it was the reverse. So we had beloved Michael, who did survive this traumatic birth. But I had to write my book, or I was going to lose my job. And at that time, Joe had just actually gotten a job. We found out that he had a job maybe, I don't know, 2 months before Michael was born. So it was all a little fraught. We didn't wait for the right, secure financial arrangements to have a kid, because it was too late to do that. So I had to finish my book, and I had this new baby. Basically, when he was about 3-4 months old, I really started back to work to write the book, which I now actually felt unable to write. And I've been avoiding it and struggling with it for years. But this required that Joe take over a huge amount of the childcare. I was nursing, so I did continue to nurse all the way through. I was nursing all the way through to close to when the book was finished. But that meant that he did a lot of all the housework. putting Michael to bed at night, just a tremendous amount of work, so that for us, the arrival of a baby actually disrupted the traditional gender norms, with Joe taking on a big chunk.
And Joe, when that happened, are you able to sort of articulate what the consequence, like, well, first of all, just your response to doing that, how that...
Well, one thing I should say, which is in Jenny's article, which you just does, but it's worth emphasizing here, the subtitle of her article is called Dilemmas of Passion and Privilege. And one of the privileges that we had, which so many upper middle class did, that we had help, right? We hired a nanny. So that was a nice story, but I didn't actually do all the work. We had somebody who was doing
well,
a lot.
Well, I went back to writing when he was in the summer, and it was another 6 weeks, I think, before we actually got ourselves together to get it. And I should just say that we had organized a kind of shared child care arrangement with somebody else, but then when Michael almost died, I thought, this baby's not leaving my sight. And daycare, this was,
right.
For me, this was not an option. This baby was going to be home and with me as much as possible. I violated the deep norms of my law school by moving home and doing all my work at home, except showing up to teach and meet the students, so that I was physically around Michael most of the day.
Mm.
Anyway, sorry.
And Joe, for you, how did that work?
So, I do remember the decision to have kids when Jenny was on tenured, and it was not at all clear she would lose her job if she didn't finish her book. It was not all clear that she would finish her book in, and I didn't have a job. I had quit my job so that I could be in Toronto with Jenny, but this just seemed like a life-affirming act, I have to say. You know, having kids, I just thought, no, something will work out, and that's always felt right. Never had any. Of course, it did work out. Wait a minute for that, and then I got tenure a year after I got the job, For me, this seemed actually, I really liked spending time with Michael when he was a baby. I really liked taking care of him, and I wasn't all that concerned about I had to do more. I don't know, I never
wasn't.
You know, some of it is personal circumstances and so on. I was not obsessed with, I had things I wanted to do, I will say, over the course of several years, so this persisted. So by the end of that period of 3 or 4 years, because first the book got accepted and then it had to be revised, and there was some, so things, you know,
so
we had counseling.
There is actually a sort of quid pro quo part. So I talk in my project about this working care, that we have to allow for small periods of intensity and ebbs and flows. And so when I finally actually submitted, I did get tenure contract, but then there were revisions. So I actually finally submitted the manuscript, handed it over to the publisher, on Daniel's, the second child's, due date. Fortunately, he was 10 days late, so we could all cover a little bit. But Joe said to me, okay, now when Daniel comes, I'm gonna take some time to get back to my own research. So you should make a commitment not to try to do any research, so he was born in April, between April and September. And I was a little resistant to this, and he said, this is your obligation as a model to your students and younger colleagues, not to try to be superwoman. You show that you're not going to try to do it all. You're going to take this time to be with your baby, and I did. And he did spend quite a bit more time catching up.
And what about in terms of your move to get a job and the working environment that you've been in, I guess you're both academics, so that places it, but in terms of your colleagues and your presentation of that commitment to the balance in your life, has it been something you've been quite open about with your colleagues, or has it been something that has had any sort of backlash or other?
No, I'm also somebody who works at home, but I'm connected with my department and happy with my colleagues. I've never felt the slightest pressure around this that I can think of.
Or resentment, or that you work at home as opposed to...
No, so the norms are different in the department. Our department, unlike the law school, had historically a kind of community orientation, and everyone was supposed to be there. Political science was never like that as a department. You could do whatever you want. Other people work at homes. So there wasn't a background set of norms. But I never felt pressured around the norms in terms of... I spent a lot of time with the kids and taking care of the kids and with household responsibilities. And I never got any negative feedback.
I'd say the other decision that we made, which was, so they were 4 and 7, and I was desperate to have... Toronto's a great city, but I wanted to be out of the city and in natural beauty. And so I really wanted to have a cottage. And we managed to get a cottage. And by my taking a job at teaching at the University of Chicago Law School. But this meant we were away all summer and without childcare. And actually, quite a bit later, without any kind of possible childcare. And so it was a decision basically to work part-time for the summer, which many of you will know is that's peak academic time. That's when you catch up on all your publication stuff. You're not teaching, you have this chunk of time. And we made a decision to basically do that half-time.
And share the load of...
And yeah. So I kind of had the morning, sort of, although they were small children. And Joe had the nighttime, where the children were asleep. But I did ponder that from time to time. But, but it did work out very well. And we think of this as having kind of cemented a kind of deep family norm of family time together, mm-hmm. of having made that commitment that our summers were family time.
Yeah. I could keep going, but I think I should share the room,
okay.
because we've got 15 minutes still ahead of us, and I'm sure there are lots of ideas bubbling or experiences that people want to share that either affirm or contrast. So is there anyone who would like to start off? Viv?
Oh, it's sort of a question more. It seems to me that the internet has made this much more complicated and probably worse for... Well, in some ways it makes it much easier to work at home because it doesn't matter when you're in your office or at home often. But in other ways, the sort of the expectation of instant responses to things and constant connection, I think makes it even harder to pull back from the working space. I think what you're saying is fantastic, and my mother would be standing up and clapping because she's been telling me this my whole life.
Yeah.
Especially about decisions, you know, of state made by people who don't know what the worth of a life is. But yeah, I just wonder if you could reflect on how much more complicated life is now in those ways that somehow makes it easier, but in some ways makes it harder to do what you're dreaming about.
So I will say that I do think it was a cost. So in this article that I wrote talks about dilemmas of passion and privilege, but also isolation. That is really, and I think to this day, that has been the price I paid, is I don't have much, haven't had much time for my colleagues, for my friends, you know, between teaching, research, and family, that pretty well eats it up. And now I'm actually thinking about trying to shift that and being around more, physically present, where I'm teaching. Because the thing I feel worst about is not having been as available to my young women colleagues as I could have been. So the isolation isn't trivial, and I don't think that email contact is the same, right? Because I think, you know, the informal chance to meet with my younger colleagues and talk, but by not being physically there, the internet doesn't help that. People, I mean, I would get emails from young colleagues if there was a crisis. They did know they could contact me if they needed to. But what you want to do is hear about it kind of before it's a crisis, right? By informal talk. And I should say that also I think one of the forms of sustaining this isolation is that I really limit my internet availability. So I'm not the greatest even on keeping up with email, and I don't do Facebook. I just don't do social media. I can't figure out how to absorb that extra set of demands on me, and I'd rather use my time, such as it is, to be more present physically.
There is a little bit of tension there. I guess you're at a stage in your life where you can be, but in making those statements about the value of those things, you have to be careful not to then impose that on those younger women who need to do what you did earlier and not be there but still maintain that connection.
Yeah. So I do see also that over the years, so when I first got to my law school, when I first started teaching at Princeton, there was only one other woman in the department, and then when I came to the law school, there were only three other women. And now, you know, we're sort of 33%, which is somehow seems to be the max that at least the elite law schools in Canada can envision.
I think there's something about the recognition that at different points in our lives we have different,
yes,
and
different
balances,
and
that
different people choose things very
differently.
That's part of what I, now that there are all these women there, I see. There are people who choose to be in their office 9 to 5. They're women who, with young children, who that's how they do it. And I was at the far end of the other. And I see there are just huge individual differences. There's not kind of a model of how it, that part of it.
And then I guess in line with your earlier discussion about changing norms, I would say perhaps part of the norm is to recognize that difference is not necessarily a disadvantage, so that within, you know, speaking to a dean, for instance, and looking at the way, there's a notion that everyone should be treated equally and that that's fair,
right.
But what is equal is, you know, the substantive formal notion is very clear here, that that if you required everyone to be in their office, because that would be fair that everybody then is, then that is going to have an unequal consequence. And so it's that sort of notion that we need to, in our workplaces, recognise that just because people are being treated differently doesn't mean that it's unfair, because it's taking into account the different needs. Different people at different stages of their lives. And so I think that would be. Any other questions? Yes.
Yeah, I have a question to Joe about immigration.
Sure.
you're both free to answer. But it appears to me that in the immigration debate, there are, in the reasonable debate, there is a. On the one hand, you have the liberal view that borders are arbitrary, and people should just come and go as they wish to. On the other hand, you have the communitarian,
right,
view of civic values, and we need to restrict our intake because we want to preserve our civic values. So I guess my question is, how do you view those two views, and how do we balance them?
So I'm actually, people tend to think of me as on the liberal side because I'm for open borders, but I'm actually quite sympathetic to the communitarian side. And
yeah.
I've written a different book called Culture, Citizenship, Community, which is about the values of the community. And part of what I try to do is to say, well, look, is this civic values is fine when it's not a defensive privilege. And that's part of the challenge, is to see the ways in which often what that means. So, if you can imagine a world in which, so I take the example of the EU, we just had a conversation about the EU. So there's free movement within the EU, of the kind of free movement that I think the world ought to provide generally. And that historically has not been a big problem, but because the economic gaps among EU countries are not that great, and people are just not gonna move from one country to another where they don't know the language, they don't have any friends, they don't have any connections, in large numbers. You know, that just isn't going to happen. So what drives the movement is the economic inequality. That, I think, is unjust.
Mm-hmm.
And so what is presented as an attempt to preserve a certain kind of community, a certain history, tradition, culture, way of life, is always implicitly a protection of economic privilege. And once that is eliminated, the problem basically goes away. And then No, I think it's good to have attachments. I care about my family more than I care about other kids. But I want a world in which, so we have privileges, that I would rather have a world in which everybody, you know, so okay, our privileges have to go, it has to come down, and everyone has the same circumstances. It's not gonna, that I'm gonna care about everybody else as much as I care about my kids. You can have these personal attachments, and you know, I pay attention to my students, not to everybody's students. You have connections and so on, and that's okay as long as the background arrangements are treating everybody fairly. So I think the tension depends upon existing injustices.
Yeah, I had a question for Jenny out of the project that you're working on now. I was just wondering how you dealt with, I presumed it would have come to you before, with potential exceptions to your 12 to 30 rule, you know, people whose job in some way might seem to require, normally I would say, more work time, you know, perhaps examples like political leaders and perhaps even music artists of particular kinds or sports people of particular kinds, where that job isn't, that type of excellence wouldn't be possible without sort of, I mean, is the answer there like the quid pro quo over a longer term, or
well,
what
there are two answers. So first, I'm glad you asked that, because one of the things that I think my picture challenges is our current understandings of excellence. So excellence tends to mean single-minded focus on one thing. And you say sports, and I really like that example, because every time the Olympics come by, we hear these stories, and we're supposed to admire these young people who do nothing but skate or run for, you know, 12 hours a day, and their parents let this happen to them. But we're all supposed to be admiring, because they managed to shave off the 1/10 of 1 second, which allowed them to win. And I'm not going to say they could have won that without doing this. I just don't think the 1/10 of 1 second is, you know, worth organizing your life this way. A little trickier is the musicians, right? So they do this too. So the first thing, but then I'll let you come back, is that I think it does and it should challenge models of excellence as single-minded devotion to one thing. It's most of us, maybe there are a few geniuses in the world, you know, who really should be doing that. But actually, even the violinist can't practice 12 hours a day. Yeah. So that's one kind of answer. But the other is, more generally, there are some jobs that will take periods of intensity that I alluded to. So, you know, you're managing a giant litigation project or, you know, a huge merger of firms, and for, it might even be 6 months or 8 months, you just have to single-mindedly do this. And then you stop, and you take 8 months off, and you catch up on the caretaking obligations that you have missed out on. So the intensity of our caring will not simply follow the arc of an individual life anymore, because, you know, where it's intense when your kids are young or when your parents are sick, when those demands are removed, you transfer your care obligations to care communities that you shape. So the caring obligations are relatively even. And what we need for almost, I think really all jobs, is some kind of job sharing model. So that, and of course there are costs, there are transaction costs to job sharing, but we recognize periods of intensity which are made up by periods of non-paid work, but what we don't do is say, because you are specially talented and doing something really important, you shouldn't be bothered doing care work.
I mean, I was just thinking as you were saying that, when politicians retire and they say, I'm doing this to spend more time with their family.
Yeah.
Perhaps from your point, they should mean it.
Yeah.
As opposed to be convenient.
Okay. I have a question, just following on from your idea of how this is going to work. I was wondering if you've connected it in your project or thought about connecting it to theories of statehood and theories of the relationship between state and citizen, because it seems like what you're proposing is going well beyond a welfare state model. And the only sort of theory that I can think of that has some parallels is Martha Feynman's idea of you know, the inevitability of dependency. So I was just wondering if your project speaks to that at all.
Yes. So So there are two, so it, you know, it's we're coming from a similar point of view in that human beings are fundamentally dependent and interdependent, and you know, my earlier work on thinking about autonomy, what autonomy cannot mean is independence. Autonomy is a set of capacities made possible by constructive relationship. Mm-hmm. So that's the background. But in terms of the state side of this, so one thing I do always want to say is that I don't picture what I'm doing as a privatization of care. Even though it does remove care, my picture is this unpaid care work extends beyond family, so it disrupts the family care nexus in certain ways. It's not paid for by the state. This is not wages for housework or better pensions for homemakers, or it's not any of that. And it's not marketized, right? This is unpaid. There would be still some paid care options, but it's removing care from its traditional relation to state, family, and market. And I think of, as I said before, the state needs to facilitate this in a whole variety of ways, but the main impetus is beyond the state. It does interfere, like you were mentioning earlier. It shifts around our public-private boundaries, because this means that kind of who does the dishes in your house is a matter of collective concern. These norms need to be, you know, socially shared and enforced, and so this norm of the private realm of the home. But as feminists, we know the dangers that's brought around domestic violence and so on. So we have to tolerate, embrace, actually, a certain disruption of the public and private. Mm-hmm. So these are public, collective, shared norms, which will be collectively deliberated about in our care communities. So it's care is very much a public project, mm-hmm. but it's not a state project. Mm-hmm. And it's one of the things that I think is important about this argument that both feminists and many people on the left make this mistake, that once they recognize something as a collective responsibility like care, they move without further argument to saying, well, that means the state should do it. Mm-hmm. But there's some pieces of it that the state are good for and other that the state isn't the best place for. And we are in a crisis of care, which is only going to get worse, you know, as types like us get older. And, you know, there are no adequate provisions, really, for the aging baby boomers. And I don't just see this as a capitulation to, you know, neoliberalism, but I do not see the state stepping in adequately mm-hmm. to, in fact, provide the support that caregivers mm-hmm. need and that people who need care need.
Dylan, as our last question.
All right, so I'm just going to a brief comment here, Joe. I really like the idea of open borders, but I just wondered, to what extent is your view of this kind of predicated on a world in which the division between first world and third world was rigid, as we're now moving into sort of a globalized world where the boundaries between first and third world are actually quite permeable. I mean, if you look at the long term of say a country like Australia, we can't guarantee, you know, jobs and a first world lifestyle, to be frank, to large parts of our working class and our lower middle class, because those, you know, the jobs and settlements, what Trump's talking about, the jobs are going elsewhere. So the boundaries, they're not rigid anymore.
Well, so, I mean, you know, one, there are different ways of analyzing the dynamics of capitalism, and one of them, Marx's classic view, is going to penetrate globally, and so everybody in the working class will be reduced to the same circumstances. Now, you know, we're a long way from that. But it does seem to me that in a just world, on that capitalist model, and the capitalist class will remain in progress, so in a just world, the inequalities within states and between states will be greatly reduced. Now, how you get there from here is a complicated question. I don't claim to have a simple answer to that. But what I want to challenge is the idea that there's something okay about these inequalities, whether they are within the state or between the states. And I want to resist the tendency to construct it as us, them, where it's the kind of the citizens versus the others, whether they're migrants or whether they're living abroad, and make that the focus, in which the kind of the disadvantage that both groups are pitted against each other, and to think about how you transform it into something more egalitarian on both ends.
So it's sort of if I can make one last comment, it's sort of rethinking of the welfare idea, because it's not justifiable to have these impoverished people overseas, whilst we sort of end
yeah,
up backwards.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, that's clearly the part of what has sustained this kind of privilege. Sure.
Well, people are departing because we have reached the 2
sure.
o'clock time, but I wanted to conclude. I'm not sure if Neve and Edward are still in the background, but I just wanted to say I really think that as feminist all men and women in any public environment should be really transparent and affirming of the ways in which we have these multiple responsibilities and to bring in more to our working life.
Can I just tell one story? I actually have a co-author on this project who's a real activist, and he tells this story about going to a meeting for financial aid for graduate students. And there's a woman there with a young baby who's crying. And she picks up the baby and she walks with the baby, but the baby doesn't stop crying. Finally, she leaves and she misses this whole important presentation. And he said that had this been a meeting of the activists who he hangs out with, people there would have immediately known we need to share this responsibility. Somebody would step in, I'll take your baby up and down the hall in the trolley for a little while, and then somebody else would have taken. But in this graduate student world, there were no such norms. And he didn't know this particular woman, so he couldn't walk up to her and said, I'll take your baby, right? Because we don't have those norms. And it's not rocket science to figure out how to do sharing. But one world he lived in had those norms deeply built in, and another world, they didn't exist at all.
So we look forward to seeing all your kids at the next event. They're not at school, of course. And on that note, on behalf of the Jenny Institute, thank you both to Jenny and to
Joe.
Both
been a pleasure.
Real great discussion. Thank you.